हेलो डॉक्टर, गुड मॉर्निंग डॉक्टर गुप्ता सर।
हेलो, गुड
सर शेरविन,
मॉर्निंग.
गुड मॉर्निंग सर। आई एम स्वाति
कैन यू
वर्मा।
हियर मी? इज इट क्लियर? वॉइस इज क्लियर?
यस सर, वेरी क्लियर सर।
ओके, हैप्पी.
सर शेल वी स्टार्ट अवर प्रोग्राम?
यस यस, ऑफ कोर्स.
आर यू रेडी सर? ओके ओके, यस
कैन यू सी द स्क्रीन?
सर,
सॉलिड पॉलीमोलेक्युलाइट्स.
यस सर, यस सर, योर
ओके.
फर्स्ट स्लाइड, यस सर। So once again, a very good morning to all the participants connected here. Myself Swati Verma, Assistant Professor from Electronics and Telecommunication Department, Sri Shankara Group of Institutions. On behalf of my organizing committee, my institute and AICT, I welcome you all on the day 4 of our FDP entitled Material Modeling for Nano Electronic Devices 2020. And as scheduled, today we are having four lectures. First lecture is by Dr. Ravin Gupta sir from Saudi Arabia. Second lecture will be from Dr. Suchetan Pal from IIT Bhilai. Third lecture will be from Dr. Manvin Tripathi sir from NIT Raipur. And last but not the least, at the 4:30 p.m., we are going to have a lecture from Professor Ravindra Pandey sir from Michigan Tech University, USA. Between this, from 3 o'clock, we are also having our day 4 lab session, which will be instructed by Dr. Mohanlal Verma sir. So now it's time for our first lecture of 2 days. The title of our talk is Solid Polymer Electrolytes for Dye-Sensitized Solar Cell, and which will be given by our speaker, Dr. Ravin Kumar Gupta. Sir has done his PhD degree in physics in the year 1997 from the Pandit Ravi Shankar Shukla University, Raipur, India, where he studied electrical properties and battery characteristic of some composite electrolytes, where he studied. He was then awarded research associateship by the CSIR India to study silver ion based solid electrolytes for battery application. Lithium ion conducting electrolytes in 2000 at the Lithium Power Technologies Incorporation, USA. He continued this work at the Inha University, South Korea, and Pandit Ravi Shankar Shukla University, India. After completing his teaching assignment at Debab University, Ethiopia, in year 2005, he moved to South Korea again to work on materials for solid oxide fuel cells and dye-sensitized solar cells. After moving to King Saud University, Riyadh, Saudi Arabia, in year 2011, he opted to continue the dye-sensitized solar cell research work. His research work has resulted in more than 75 articles of international repute. Currently, he has a few research projects on his hands to work on dye-sensitized solar cell materials. I welcome you, sir. We are really honored to have to connect with you, that you joined with us, sir. I now invite Dr. Ravin Kumar Gupta sir to start his presentation.
Good morning, everybody. I'm thankful to the organizers for giving me the opportunity to share my knowledge on the electrolytes, especially for the dye-sensitized solar cells. This is the content. I'm going to introduce about the solar cell. Then I will talk about the redox couple electrolytes. Then I will discuss the work what I have done on the blend system, which is polyethylene oxide succinonitrile blend. Then just little talk about the future prospects. Then I will close my presentation. So first is solar cell. We all know it is an electrical device which converts the energy of light directly into the electricity. Because we use sunlight, so this is a type of renewable energy source. Why we have to use solar cell? If you see this picture, world solar energy map, between the near the tropics, Tropic of Cancer and Tropic of Capricorn, and in between, you can see the sunlight irradiance is very, very high. It's quite high. It is sufficient to generate the electricity. So now question is, what are the types of solar cells? So we have silicon-based solar cells, which has been commercialized. Everywhere you will get the same thing. Next is the fifth type solar cells, in which we have gallium arsenic, indium, phosphorus. Third is the chalcogenide type solar cells, like CIGS, cadmium, tellurium. These two are actually thin films solar cells. Then disensitized solar cells, quantum dot solar cells, organic solar cells, and perovskite solar cells. So I will just show the cell configuration. I will not discuss. So first is the silicon-based solar cells. This is for the amorphous type solar cell. You can see here, this is glass-based system. We can use polymer, we can use stainless steel, or maybe ITO glass also. So this is the configuration for the amorphous or nanocrystalline solar nanocrystalline silicon-based solar cell. Here we have FTO glass, then index matching, then we have amorphous material, then intermediate reflector, then nanocrystalline silicon, zinc oxide, then we have reflector. This is for your amorphous silicon with the this another type. And like that, we have so many types of silicon-based solar cells. Next is the gallium arsenic-based solar cell. Here we have substrate of germanium or gallium arsenic. In that, we have the gallium arsenium deposition of gallium deposition, gallium arsenic deposition. Then we have gallium indium phosphorus. Then we have the anti-reflection coating. If someone wants, they can modify this junction also. Then we have chalcogenide-based solar cells. This is copper, indium, gallium, selenide, which is nowadays very, very good. Very good efficiency. If you see, it can be prepared on glass or stainless steel or titanium sheet. So here we have deposition of molybdenum, then P-type CGS, then N-type cadmium sulfide, then intrinsic zinc oxide, then N-type zinc oxide, or ITO. Next, it is CDTE. This is the glass. You can see this is also very, very compact, very thin film, actually. Very good. Next is the quantum dot solar cell. Professor Kamat actually proposed three types of configurations, but we use number C, where we have the quantum dots here, which is then TiO2 has sensitized by this quantum dot. So cadmium sulfide or PBS, CDSE absorbs the light. Okay. So this is the main thing. This is the organic solar cells. Efficiency is nowadays also very, very good. This is the glass based. You can make on the glass, you can make on the polymer, any type. It's very, very good. So this is the configuration. Next is the perovskite-based solar cell. This is the FTO glass. Then we have very compact TiO2. It is around 150 nanometer, you can see. Then we have major porous TiO2, around 400 nanometer. It is filled with the methyl ammonium lead iodide or similar perovskite material. Then we have cuboid of the perovskite material, then hole transport material, and finally, the current collector, which is made of gold. So this is the typical plot of a solar cell. This is the current density versus voltage curve. And the efficiency of any solar cell is given by the product of short circuit current density, open circuit voltage, fill factor, which is divided by the intensity of the incident light, which is generally standard, actually, 100 milliwatt per centimeter square. So if I'm not mentioning the intensity of the incident light, means it is 100 milliwatt per centimeter square. And the fill factor is given by the P maxima divided by JSC into VOC. So P maximal is actually when we plot the power as a function of voltage, we have somewhere here the maximum value of the power. So from this power, we can get the fill factor also. So we need three parameters actually: JSC, VOC, and fill factor. This is the cell efficiencies recorded by the National Renewable Energy Laboratory, USA. They record actually from the labs, from the research papers, from the companies, and they present here. So this is up to date September 2020. And this is the table published in the Progress of Photovoltaic Research Application. Professor Green is responsible for the tabulating the record certified efficiencies. So for the silicon-based solar cell, for the nanocrystalline material, you can see efficiency is very, very high, 26.7%. This is for 79 centimeter square. For the DS wafer, this is 23.8. Area is 246 centimeter square. For the thin film submodule, it is 21.2. But when we go for the mini module, it is just half, less than half, 10.5%. So this is the, these are the companies, those have fabricated this. This has been commercialized means. Another is here, the third, fifth cells, gallium arsenic. You can see the efficiency is very high, 29.1% for the 1 centimeter square. Then when we increase the area, 4 centimeter square, this is multicrystalline or polycrystalline, this is 18.4. For indium phosphorus, this is 24.2. For GCS, CIGS, this is 23.35. For CDTE, 21%. Sorry. Then for the amorphous silicon, you can see it's very low, 10.2%. So we use actually commercially amorphous based silicons or polycrystalline based silicon wafers. So efficiency is 10.2 or 11.9. When we go for the modules, it is similar, 9, 10, something like that. So, but it's damn cheap, damn cheap. Then we go for the perovskite cells, it is 21.6. When we go for the mini module, it is 18. For Dyson size solar cells, SARP has reported 11.9%. When we go for the mini module, it is 10.7%. For submodule, it is 8.8. For organic cell, you can see 13.4%. So this is the up-to-date result, up-to-date efficiency published in September 2020, and I have presented here. Now, next is the Dyson size solar cell. Here I want to discuss you silicon-based solar cell now is damn cheap. Per kilowatt, we need only 5 rupees or 10 rupees, just 7 cents. In US, it is just 7 cents per kilowatt. Per kilowatt hour. So this is nowadays cheap. 10 years back, it was very expensive, $1. Now it is just 7 cents, just imagine. But still we are trying to improve. We want to develop new solar cells, new types of solar cells. Now I'm going to talk about the Dyson style solar cells, which is the present topic. So actually it was discovered by Regan and Gergel in 1991. It is N-type DSSC. We also have P-type DSSC, but I'm not going to talk about the P-type DSSC. And this N-type DSSC is also known as Gergel cell. why it is very good. If you compare with the others, why it is better, why it is good. The reasons are it has no toxic heavy metals. It uses low cost materials. It is ecologically and biologically benign. We don't need expensive equipment for manufacturing. We can prepare on flexible sheets. We can reach terawatt scale also. If we use this cell, we can go for the terawatt scale also. You can see here, payback time is very, very less. Just 1 year. Whatever we invest, we get back within 1 year. Performance outside, inside is very, very good. And it captures light from all angles of incident. For the silicon-based solar cell, it is angle dependent. But for the Dyson Sky solar cell, we don't need the angle. Okay, we can take the direction of the light from anywhere. This picture shows the DSSC components. We have the FTO glass here. The CC is the current collector, FTO glass. We can make PET also, conducting polymer for flexible sheet. Then this is the counter electrode, which is PT. Then we have iodide, triiodide based redox mediator. Then we have working electrode, which is made of major porous TiO2, sensitized by the dye. Then we have current collector again, which is flow FTO. And this is the sun sign, here we sign. So important part is here, the dye. Dye absorbs the light, gets excited from the HOMO to LUMO level. It gives the excited dye. Then this excited dye results in, gives an electron, which goes to the conduction band of the TiO2 and becomes oxidized. So you can see here ruthenium-based dyes. This is the mechanism for the dye-sensitized solar cell. This dye absorbs the light, goes, get excited, release the electron. It goes through the major porous TiO2. It passes through the load, comes to the counter electrode, where electrolyte reduces the triiodide, and it becomes the iodide. It migrates through the electrolyte, and then this electrolyte, this iodine, gives an electron, intercept this back electron reactions 5 and 6, and then it interrupts the these reactions. So this is the major part. This is the role of the electrolyte. It interrupts these back electrons, back reactions. So, and then it regenerate the dye. So this is the basic mechanism. This is the how this was. So it's very, very simple. If you see, it's very, very simple. Now I'm going to talk about the classification of the redox coupled electrolytes. First is the liquid electrolytes. When we use liquid electrolyte, it's very, very easy to make. It's very, very good. Here, viscosity is very low, around 1 millipascal second. Conductivity is very high, around 10⁻²⁻³ Simon per centimeter. Diffusion coefficient of triiodide is also high, 10⁻⁵ to 10⁻⁶ centimeter square per second. Preparation is easy. It also gives good interfacial contacts. This is the major problem when we use the solid polymer electrolytes. We don't get good interfacial contacts. So these are the some organic solvent-based electrolytes. Red Gel gave this electrolyte. He reported 7.9%. It was published in Nature in 1991. Efficiency, you see, is 7.9%. But not 100 milliwatt per centimeter. It is just 8.3. Then the same group used the potassium, they added the potassium iodide in this electrolyte. They got 7.12% at 75 milliwatt per centimeter square. After that, you can see so many electrolytes are available. Now you can get these electrolytes from the so many companies, from Daisol, from the Solaronics, from the Dynamo, and conductivity is around 1.6, around 10 to the power minus 2 Simon per centimeter. But there's a problem with the organic solvent. It creates leakage. It has a problem of volatility, flammability, reactions with sealant and electrode. That's why we want to replace the organic solvent by some other liquid. So we use ionic liquid, which offers good chemical and thermal stability, negligible vapor pressure, non-flammability, high solubility for organic or inorganic salt, and wide electrochemical window. But disadvantage is conductivity is around, is very less, actually around one order less. And the diffusion coefficient is also one order less. So here I have listed, I have shown the some imidazolium ion-based ionic liquids. And these are the electrolytes. You can see here, conductivity is here. Actually, I'm trying to present the material aspects. What materials we have used in the past. And if I get the conductivity, I put the conductivity value. And then if efficiency is available, I put the efficiency because it's necessary. Efficiency is important. So I put the efficiency. So this is the electrolyte published by the Boschulu in 2002. Here efficiency is 5.41%. In 2005, Najruddin et al. Published this paper. They reported 11.4%. It's quite high, it's still high. But the problem is this is not certified. The certified frequency conversion efficiency was reported by Chiba et al. In 2006. It is 11.2%. So they use ionic liquids. Here you can see. But they also use the organic solvents. So this is a mixture of ionic liquid and organic solvents. Here we use iodine. This is the gliadium thiocyanate. For increasing the open circuit voltage, we use TBP, which is tert-butylpyridine. So you can see here, when we use another materials like NMBI, PM2, EMI, DC, and this is mixtures actually, then we get 6.6%. Iodine is common here. You can see here, iodine is common. Everywhere we have to use iodine because these are iodide, triiodide based redox mediators. So we have to add iodine as a source. And then we use the ionic liquid. So here you can see we have also added the means here. If you see, we if we use only ionic liquid, efficiency is less. But when we use ionic liquid with the organic solvents, then efficiency is quite high. So these electrolytes are also available, and commercially you can see. Conductivity is very, very high. This is from the Daisol. Conductivity is very high. When you use this iodolite HI30, you can see efficiency is very good, 9.6%. Next is the some succinonitrile-based electrolyte. In this succinonitrile, people have this, Byron et al. Used the ionic liquid. They reported these efficiencies. They didn't do any other thing. They just used the electrolyte and reported the efficiency. That's it. So what I did in 2000 last it has been published recently in 2020. So what I did, I optimized the conductivity. I showed that when we increase the concentration of ionic liquid, it increases the conductivity, then it starts to decrease. So we should not add too much ionic liquid. It should be less. And if we take SnI2 lithium iodide, it is solid. You can see here, it is solid till 40 degrees Celsius, then it becomes liquid. But when we add ionic liquid, it becomes liquid. You can see there's no phase transition. And it gives you, it gives the vocal Tarman-Fulcher type empirical relation. So I tried to explain through the FTIR, and I found when we increase the concentration of the ionic liquid, we have too much, it distorts the molecular structure of the succinonitrile. This is the problem. So it decreases the electrical conductivity, you can see here. Next is the alternative redox couples in liquid form. So in we also have other ionic liquid, another organic salts, organic solvent based liquid electrolytes. Here you can see bromide, bromine, selenium, this, then cobalt based. This cobalt based is nowadays very, very good. It has given efficiency of 11.9%. It is reported by Eli et al. Then it has further modified, which gives very high, more than 13%, 14%. So I have not listed, but almost similar. You can see here, this is copper ion conductors. Then we have this type of materials. But you can see here, the cobalt-based electrolytes are very, very good. So this is our future plan. Now I'm working on the cobalt-based electrolytes, solid polymer electrolytes. Next is the gel or quasi-solid electrolytes. The problem with the liquid electrolytes is the organic solvents get evaporated. It is flammable. So how to remove, naturally subsidize this problem? So we use quasi-solid electrolytes or gel electrolytes. So it is a liquid impregnated electrolyte. It is prepared by incorporating a large amount of organic solvent or ionic liquid mixed with redox couple into a gelator. What is gelator? It may be a low molecular weight polymer, a nanoparticle, a biopolymer, or PVDF HFP. If we have no gelator, still we can have self-gelation. So these are the examples of the gel or quasi-solid electrolytes. I put little actually. Here you can see this is the ionic liquid based electrolyte, but when we have gelation, low molecular weight gelator, this is gel, you can see here. Okay. So this is the advantage. And efficiency is also good, you can see. And this is the some materials, you can see the diffusion, the conductivity is very, very good, 7.2 millisiemen per centimeter, you can see here, very, very good. Efficiency is also good, 4.98. Diffusion coefficient also high, 1.2 into 10 to the power minus 6. So these are the advantages. Here I have put the nanofiller based gel electrolytes. It has been reported by Venkateshan and Lee, published in Coordination Chemistry Reviews. Here we use clay material. You can see here, when we use clay, the efficiency gets increased largely from 3.17 to 5.41%. Here, so many examples you can see with liquid electrolytes. This is with the liquid electrolytes. Here we have added maybe polymer or maybe no polymer. So when we use pure PEO, So efficiency is 4.21, but when we add MMT, it is 4.7%. But here we use the solvent. Okay, MPN is a solvent. So that's why it's very high, 4.21. If we use only, if we have no MPN, no ionic liquid, it will be less, very less. Then we have another material, you can see very, very high, 7.55%, 7.66. So it's good to add nanofiller. You can see it's very, very good. This is for the nanomica. This is for the hydrotelcite. This is the for the SiO2 based fumed SiO2, 6.1. This is for the surface modified fume SiO2. Like that, we have, you can see SiO2. So efficiency is very, very good. 9.5%, you can see it's very good. Excellent. When you use nanofiber, SiO2 nanofiber, it is 4.85. When we use PVDF in this ILSBA, this is the nanofiber, this is 5.29. When we use SiO2 in ionic liquid with IPVDF and others, it is 5.75. Like that, you can see this is TiO2 dispersed system. Very good. You can see efficiency very high, 10.23 also. So efficiency is very good. This is the advantage when we use nano fillers. This is another. This with the zinc oxide, copper aluminum oxide, SNO2, titanium carbonate, aluminum nitride, so base nano fillers. Then activated carbon, carbon plate, carbon nanotubes. Like that, we have, you can see efficiency values is very, very good. Here also we have graphite, added the graphite, it improves actually. When we add the nanofiller, it improves the cell efficiency everywhere. You can see this is graphene oxide, this is graphite, this is graphite, this is in flex somewhere, it is spherical. Like that, we have so many. So when we use liquid or gel electrolytes, we have the problem of the reduction in long-term stability. When we go for the high temperature, we get the high pressure also, it breaks the sealing and leakage, then it gives the leakage, and we also have the manufacturing problem. That's why we have to replace the liquid or gel electrolytes by solid polymer electrolytes. When we are in India, in Sahara desert, or in Saudi Arabia, where we have so many deserts, temperature grows very, very high, 50 degrees Celsius, 54 degrees Celsius. And duration is very, very long, not 1 month, not 2 months. It is very, very long, maybe 5, 6 months, 7 months, 8 months, like that. So temperature is very, very high. That's why when we are in the tropics area or in between, production of the electricity by solar cell is very, very good. It is very good for the countries like Saudi Arabia, India, Algeria, Dubai, UAE, like that. It's very, very good. This is the list of the biopolymers. This has been reported by Prabodh Singh group from the Delhi. This is the review article actually. So here they have worked on the so many biopolymers. Here you can see efficiency is not good at all. You can see here very low, very, very low. And if they use the nanofillers, then only little okay. But when we use the ionic liquid, it's okay, you can see, with the ionic liquids, 6.87. Here another list, but efficiency is here, less, you can see. This is another list with the with the salt. So here you can see efficiency is less, but here very good. But here they have used the solvents like that. Then I'm now going to talk about the solid electrolytes, the main topic. So plastic crystal based electrolytes, succinylnitrile is a plastic crystal, which is a non-ionic and low molecular weight plastic crystal. It is a body centered face, and it is a plastic, it has the plastic phase between minus 38 degrees Celsius to melting temperature 58 degrees Celsius, and it has high dielectric constant about 55. It has waxy nature. So when we use this electrolyte with others, we have very good conductivity. But when we use this SN with the ionic liquids, conductivity is, you can see, very, very high, very good. And diffusion coefficient also very high. And that's why the efficiency is very, very good. So there are so many reports here. You can see here I have listed almost all electrolytes. So here you can see efficiency is 5, 5.5, 6.5. Here some more. So what I did, as I told you earlier, I use SN, but only this one et al. Use only the electrolyte. They didn't do anything. No conductivity measurement, no structural properties. They did nothing. So what I did, I just optimized the conductivity. I found when we increase the concentration of the lithium iodide, it is solid, it's completely solid, and conductivity increases. But when we go for the composite electrolytes or other electrolytes, when conductivity increases, activation energy also decreases. But here we got the just opposite behavior. Here you can see activation energy is increasing. Means this SN interacts with the triiodide and hampers the motion of the triiodide. So this is the one negative thing with this succinylnitrile, right? But it's still okay. It's very, very good. You can see conductivity is very good. It's still good. So efficiency also okay. So now next is the solid polymer electrolytes. Here you can see we have PEOKII2 system. Conductivity is 6 into 10 to the minus 5, and efficiency is around 2. When we use copolymer with these salts, you can see here conductivity is around 10 to the minus 5, efficiency is 1.6. So here you can see efficiency is very less or moderate. When we use potassium iodide, it is just 0.32%. When we add the nanofiller, you can see is very, very high, 4.2%. It's very, very good. Then when we use another nanofiller, SiO2, fumed SiO2, this is 3.71%. So I found when we add any low polymer weight material into the polyethylene oxide, we improve the conductivity and also improve the efficiency. So on the basis of this, these are some more solid polymer electrolytes. On the basis of this, I use succinylnitrile and made the solid polymer electrolytes. So I will discuss this another 10 minutes and then I will conclude. So here polyethylene oxide, why we use polyethylene oxide? Because it offers self-standing film formation, thermal stability up to 200 degrees Celsius, eco and bio-friendliness, low material cost, salt solvating, and ion transport through ethylene oxide. These are the these are the properties what we get from the PEO. But the problem is when we use only PEO, conductivity is very less because of the crystallinity, high crystallinity. So in order to reduce the crystallinity of the PEO, we have to add some material, low molecular weight or ionic liquid or something like that. But condition is it should be solid. So succinylnitrile is very good melting temperature is very low, dielectric constant is very high, and also it acts as a plasticizer. So I use this thing. So then I made the blend and I studied completely. So this is the values. Conductivity is here. You can see around 10 per. When you have the PO, it is 10 or minus 10. But when we add the succinyl nitrile, 50% weight percent, it is around 10 power minus 8. This is the advantage. So here we use salt mixture, lithium iodide or potassium iodide with the iodine. There's one problem with the succinyl nitrile. It gets sublimated because this has a property, sublimation. It is thermally unstable after 58 degrees Celsius. You can see here, when we hold it, it starts to sublimate. See here, you can see it has removed from the POSN, totally. Totally removed. So this is the problem with the succinyl nitrile. But when we have, when we add with this PO, it makes the, it stabilizes this thing. So this is the electrical conductivity. With PO, you can see PO conductivity is very low, but when we add the salt, it is 10 power minus 5 Simon per centimeter. But with the blend, it is more than 10 power minus 4 Simon per centimeter. It is 10 to 10 power minus 4. But when we use the potassium iodide, you can see conductivity is very, very high, 7 into 10 power minus 4. But with the PO, it is 10 power minus 5. So one order enhancement, more than one order enhancement in the electrical conductivity. So this is the temperature variation. When we use polyethylene oxide, you can see here, it is almost linear here. But when we use the blend, PO, succinyl nitrile blend, it is not linear at all. It is not linear, okay? It gives you a curvature, you can see here, downward curvature. Means it is in amorphous phase and it follows the Ogle-Tamman-Fulcher type behavior. Okay? This is true for both. When you talk about the blend lithium iodide or blend potassium iodide. So this shows the a decrease in the crystallinity when we add the salt. This is the activation energy. It's very, very low, 0.1, 0.08, 0.14. For the optimum conducting electrolyte, 0.086 electron volt, means very, very good. So the ionic transport is very easy in these electrolytes. If you see the XRD with the PO, when we add lithium iodide, when we add the lithium iodide, it has suppressed the PO peak, but still it is present. But when we add this into the blend, we have totally suppressed the peaks of the blend. So this is the advantage. Means it is amorphous, completely amorphous. The same thing for this blend KII2 also. When we have the FTIR, you can see lot of changes, especially in the site, this site. You can see here, totally different, totally different. Here also you can see the same thing. I have put this thing. You can see here, this is the vibrational modes of the CS2. You can see from the blend 2875, it has shifted to 2879 for both, and for this from 2899, so it has shifted. It means there's a large shift. So it, when we add the salt into this blend, it modifies the CH2 structure. This is the advantage. That's why it becomes amorphous. So this is the optical property, polarized optical microscopy. So here you can see this is pure PEO, but when we add the salt, it becomes amorphous. But when we have blend, you can see it is crystalline. Okay, still crystalline, but crystallinity is less as compared to PEO. So here you can see it is very less. Like when we see the this, you can see this is 100x, this is 400x. This is for 400x. So you can see the sporides. These are the crystallites here. So it shows that when we add the salt, it makes the amorphous. This is the advantage. You can see it makes the amorphous. So here we have the thermal property. This is the DSC results. When we have PEO, the crystallinity is very high, 82%. But when we add the lithium iodine, it is just 5.3%. For the blend, it is 25.2%. But when we add lithium iodide, it is almost zero. Crystallinity is almost zero. You can see here. The same thing for blend KII2. This is a photovoltaic study. So when we use PEO lithium iodine, it is efficiency is very less, 0.5. But when we use blend, it is 2%. With this also, you can see less. And with potassium iodide, it is 1.35. So here, there's one strange thing. Conductivity is high. It's higher than this, but efficiency is less. So question, this you can here, you can see incident photon to current conversion efficiency, IPC. So the question was, if conductivity is high, why efficiency is less? So the problem is here, when we use potassium or higher sodium or something like that, when we increase the ionic radius of the salt, it acts as a plasticizer and increases the conductivity, but it decreases the it increases the dye regeneration time also. So we did the transient absorption spectroscopy. When we have no electrolyte, the dye regeneration time is very high, 44 microsecond. But when we use electrolyte, so it is very less. So for the B means your blend lithium iodide iodine, it is 5 microsecond. When we have the potassium, it is 8 microsecond. But when we have liquid, pure ionic liquid, pure liquid organic solvent based liquid commercially available, it is 1.9 microsecond. So this is the problem. So dye generation is very very low in case of the potassium or sodium or something like that. So now next is the future prospects. As I told you, Chiba et al. And Najaruddin et al. Reported very high efficiency, around 11.2% for the organic solvent based ionic liquid based disensitized solar cells, around 11 point, you can see 11.1 or 11.4%, very, very high. But when we go for the cobalt based system, it is not 11 now, it is 13.6%. Or 13, this is by the Jiang et al. Published in the ACS Energy in 2019, last year only. And this is by the next is 13% by the Matthew et al. In the Nature Chemistry. So efficiency is now more than 13%. It's very, very good. So being a person of these polymer electrolytes, working on the solid electrolytes, now, in order, because you, as you know, I have discussed, the liquid electrolytes are not good at all for the stability term. So we have to replace the liquid by the solid. So this is the future prospects. We have to turn this the liquid into solid. And I have one project here. My target is to change the liquid by solid. So I am now working on the cobalt based electrolytes. You can see here I have used PEO and then so many things, so many salts. And here I have used succinonitrile. And then I made the blend POSN equal weight fraction. Here you can see conductivity is very less, around 10 power minus 6 Simon per centimeter. But when we use pure succinonitrile, it is 10 power minus 3 Simon per centimeter. And when we use blend, when we mix together, it's still 10 power minus 3 Simon per centimeter. Conductivity is still high and all are solid. All are solid. This is the advantage. I studied the temperature variation also. So PO based, it is linear, you can see. It gets then melted here and then it becomes the liquid like amorphous state. Actually, this is amorphous. This is not liquid, but amorphous state. When we have the succinonitrile, you can see it is a increase. Then it melts here around 35 degrees Celsius or 40 degrees Celsius. And then we have linearity. For the blend, it is not linear at all. It has a curvature. You can see here, it has a curvature. So it is amorphous. Again, what we have seen earlier for the for this type of electrolytes, POSN, lithium iodide, or potassium iodide based electrolyte, we have the same thing now. So now I'm very, very happy. So if someone wants to work on this type of thing, they can work. So it will increase the conductivity. It will also helps to improve the stability of the solar cell, especially in the high temperature. And I want to acknowledge Professor Hyuri from Korea and Dr. Idris Beja from Saudi Arabia. And these are the equipments. Actually, for the solar cell, we have everything. This is the IV study system. This is the IPC study system. This is the surface profilometer to measure the thickness of the material. This contact based Dektok 150. This is the transient absorption spectrometer. Here we have NDR laser. Then we have UV visible spectrometer. Then we have high key 3522 meter. This is the for ionic conductivity. I have also purchased recently the Palm Sense 4 for the diffusion coefficient measurement, for the LSV, for the cyclometry, and for the electrical conductivity also. We have spin coater. We have deep coater also. We have ultrasonic processor. Like that, we have everything. And now I'm just closing. Thank you so much for listening. Hello.
Yes, sir. Hello.
Yes, I have finished.
To you, sir?
Yeah, I finished.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir, for sharing your expertise with us. Now I request participants if they have any doubt. Hello, participants. If you have any doubt, you can directly ask to sir, or you can type in the chat box.
I'm using first time, actually. Actually, I have seen my children. They are now online. They are studying online. My yes, wife sir. Is also teaching online. So, but I'm using first time, actually.
Yes, sir.
Really, I'm happy.
Yes, sir. Okay, they are just typing, thank you, sir.
Mm-hmm. Thank you so much. Okay.
Okay,
so is it clear to everybody? Is it okay, everybody? I tried to give the material aspects of the Dyson size solar cell. Of course, in that materials, we have solid polymer electrolytes, liquid electrolytes, everything. So I gave the glimpse of the materials, what we use. Thank you so much. I'm happy to interact with all of you.
So Dr. Gupta, sir?
Yes.
So there is one question in the chat box.
Okay.
So please comment on the scalability of nanomaterials-based solar cells.
Nanomaterials, when we use nanomaterials, actually we use nanomaterials. First we take the any solvent, then we put the nanomaterials for, we store it for 24 hours at room temperature. Then we add the salt, etc. Then polymer, like that, we prepare. So in this case, actually, many times it doesn't increase the conductivity, but it improves the efficiency. It improves its efficiency because it helps to migrate the ions. So this is the importance of the nanomaterials. If you want, I can show my one paper. If can you see the screen?
Yes, sir.
Okay. This is the paper I'm going to show you, which is under consideration. This is the my paper, which is going, which is under consideration in the Journal of Power Source. This is for the effect of leponite nanoclay dispersion on electrical structural photovoltaic properties of dispersed electrolyte. This is the iodine triiodide based system. Here you can see. Here you can see. Conductivity is here. I want to show you. This is a little improvement in the conductivity at 2.5%. But when you go for the efficiency, efficiency increased from 2.4% to 3.7%. Conductivity improvement is less, but the efficiency improvement is very, very high because of an increase in the short circuit photo density, current density. Here you can see from 5.3 to 11.8% milliampere per centimeter square. So it helps in the current. So this is the advantage of the nanoparticles. So you get less improvement in the conductivity, but very good improvement in the current density. So this is the advantage. This is the, you can see the results again, curvature. This is the, you can see FTIR also here. I tried to explain through the FTIR. This is XRD. So it is going to publish in the Journal of Power Source. I have submitted the revised manuscript. So is it clear? Here also, here you can see the polarized optical microscopy also, DSC also. Then this is the thing, this is the IV study, this is IPC study, this is EIS study. Like that, I have presented everything actually. We do everything here, okay? We do from A to Z. Anything else? Anything else? किसी को और कुछ पूछना है?
Hello participants, is there any other doubt related to solar cells?
Okay, sir, I think they understood.
So thank you so much.
Okay, thank you, sir, for sharing your valuable time with us.
So are you a sister of Aarti Verma?
No, sir, no, sir.
Okay. So thank you so much.
Yes, bye. Yes, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Have a nice day. Bye.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. So I'm happy. Really, I'm very happy.
Yes, I will want to ask for participants. Just Dr. Gupta sir is senior of our Dr. M. Mohanlal Verma sir from Pandit Ravi Shankar Shukla University. Sir is in Saudi Arabia, and sir has shared his time with us. Thank you once again, sir.
Thank you.
Okay, sir.